Tonight, I would like to begin this board meeting with a message from our state ed monitors. And this is a message to the Board of Education and the community. And it reads as follows. East Ramapo is a single community made up of many parts. There are different needs and interests, but a common priority of offering opportunity and care for their children. The entire community wants what is best for the children of East Ramapo. Reaching a compromise on the school district budget and programming is central to this, and not all sides will see eye to eye. The district is putting forth a compromise in the best sense. Simply put, it benefits all children in our community. The board will propose a plan to move the community forward while achieving a delicate balance of needs and interests. We feel strongly that this plan is a very healthy step forward for the long-term financial health of the school district and all sides will see the benefit for the children of East Ramapo. I have read in your hearing a message from the monitors to the Board of Education and to the community. This evening, I'd like to start this discussion with a little background on the base budget. A base budget was initially put forth under the limits of the New York State property tax cap. This means the increase and the local levy was capped at 1.48% of last year's local levy of $149 million. This resulted in an increase of $2.2 million for the 2017-2018 budget. The original budget included 12 new teachers, being bilingual and EML, English as a new language, at the elementary and high school level. Due to the change in federal law, Dr. Shanahan, 5 other teachers now have to be paid with state and local dollars. That's due to a change in the federal law. There are also plans for after-school art, additional summer programs, as well as the fixed cost increases of personnel salaries and healthcare benefits. There are funds in the original budget to support what we're calling the teacher collaboration model, so that teachers can have additional joint collaborative time. This was birthed by teachers, for teachers, and everybody is excited about the opportunity to have professional collegial talk about student achievement with their colleagues. Let's talk about scenarios. The district and the board considered various scenarios related to non-public transportation for inclusion in the budget. The budget originally included 5 days of transportation for non-public students when the public schools are closed, such as superintendent's conference days, winter break. Well, as we all know, the commissioner stepped in and disallowed the inclusion of such funding in the school budget because it was her understanding that the only way additional days could be included in the budget would be if there were additional revenues as well. Let's look at the amendments. So with those five additional days, that total was $505,000. The budget has been amended so that with that $505,000, 4.5 full-time high school, full-time teachers will be hired for the high school at $292,500. The teacher collaboration model to enable teachers K-12 to spend additional time collaborating will cost $81,000. Then you factor in the Social Security benefits, retirement contributions, and medical insurance, and that will come to $505,000 total. What are the reductions? We are moving $505,000 from our line item of transportation and putting it into those categories that I just mentioned as additions. Collaboration with the commissioner. The commissioner, the board president, the superintendent, the New York State Council, and both monitors met on April 25th. And the goal was to find a way to move forward productively to serve all of the children of East Ramapo. And what a great collaborative meeting that was. So, what's the concept of an override of the tax cap? Here's some more background. The concept of an override of the tax cap was first raised by the monitors back in December of 2015. Why? Given the six budget failures between 2004 and 2012, the district's local tax levy was $8.7 million less in local tax money than it might have been with successful budget passes each year. I think I want to say that again. With six budget failures between 2004 and 2012, the district's local tax levy was $8.7 million less in local tax money than it might have been with successful budget passes each year. The monitors have said, and they've said it frequently, and they've said it in public, that at some point an override would be necessary, and it would be necessary to begin the process of catching up. It would be necessary to begin the process of rebuilding our district. The board president, the superintendent, and the monitors fully supported the discussion of a plan to propose an override vote to the public on May 16th. The East Ramapo Central School District, the local property tax rate is, I'm going to say, average for peer districts, but on the low end for Rockland County. Proposing an override is not taken lightly. And without detailed planning and without utter scrutiny, as a result of the discussion that we had on April 25th, the district is determined to prepare a plan to bring to the to bring an override to the Board of Education, East Ramapo Central School District's Board of Education, and if supported and approved by the commissioner, it would then be on the ballot May 16th. If supported and approved by the commissioner, it would be on the ballot May 16th. So let's talk about some key points. There are benefits to all children in the community. It starts to rebuild our tax base in support of our public schools. Remember that, 8.7. It provides for a more than 1 million increase in public programming annually, starting in the 2018-2019 school year. I can think about just where that money would go. Upfront costs for transportation in 2017-2018 is greatly reduced by increased state aid reimbursement in 2018 and 2019 and beyond. Let's look at the tax levy for 2017-2018. A 1% override is proposed above the state cap of 1.48%. The 1.48% will generate $2.2 million. And the 1% override will generate another $1.5 million. Altogether, the proposed override will generate $3.7 million in new local revenues for a total local revenue for 2017-2018 of $152.9 million. Achieving the override is important for several reasons. I'm going to give three reasons. One, the override will increase the tax base levy upon which the 18-19 tax cap will be imposed. A larger base results in a larger tax levy each and every year moving forward. This is exactly what the monitors have been discussing since December of 2015 as a long-term strategy and investment by the community to drive more funds to the public schools. Reason two. Second, the new budget will allow for all the public school programmatic and staffing gains originally proposed by the superintendent, plus an additional $100,000 in 2017-2018. Listen, 63% of the $3.7 million in new local revenues generated by this plan in 2017-2018 will serve the public school program, and 37% for non-public. In 2018-2019, this proportion shifts to 90% and 10% respectively. The additions to the public school programming include, I'm going to repeat, 12 new teachers, the maintaining of 5 teachers who are no longer being allowed to be funded through Title II dollars, an enhanced instructional support for teacher aides, additional support for teacher collaboration, and after-school and summer programs. Third, the new budget will allow for the reinstatement of busing for non-public children on days the public schools are not in session. 14 days were cut in 2011, and will now be reinstated. This will allow for the safe and orderly passage of 26,000 non-public school children when the public schools are not operating. Let's look at the amendments related to the tax cap override. Additions, transportation in the amount of $1,414,000. Now, to note, in 2018, 2019, and thereafter, that's important, and thereafter, the district will receive $1 million in reimbursement for this cost, resulting in an annual cost of $400,000 for this expense category, and $1 million in additional funds for public schools. One high school FTE teacher with benefits, $91,000. The teacher collaboration model, K-12, that will be an additional $9,315. The cost of non-public transportation is approximately $100,000, excuse me, per day, and is subject to New York State transportation aid at a rate of 73%. So with the money levied by the tax cap, the override, the district will be able to pay for its public programs. The district will be able to pay for its public programs, the 14 days of non-public transportation, that's $1.4 million, and use all of the $1 million in new reimbursement on public program each and every year. Each and every year. The net cost of the 14 days of non-public transportation is $400,000, and the net gain to the public programming will be increased by $1 million per year, starting with the 2018-2019 budget. Rebuilding the instructional programs. I'm going to repeat. The state transportation aid reimbursement increase every year after. Approximately $1 million in benefits to public education. The higher tax levy base, $1.5 million, and annual additional funding for public students. So here's the balanced budget. Here's the revenue, and here's the expense. Balanced budget. Not my favorite topic. Every time I think about contingency, I think about those years, but I'm duty bound to read. Under a contingency budget, the district's tax levy for the coming year must be the same or less than the tax levy for the current year. A failure of the proposed 2017-18 budget may result in a state-defined contingency budget. In the event the board adopts a contingency budget, the tax levy may be no greater than the levy of the prior year. Said that. Under a contingency budget, there would also be a cap on the administrative component of a budget. The contingency budget for 17-18 school year would allow local revenues to be no larger than the 2016-2017 levy. This would result in a budget cut of $3.7 million to the proposed budget and no enhancement to any programs. A contingency budget, now I'm going to repeat, funds only teacher salaries and those items the board determines to be ordinary contingent expenses. Ordinary contingent expenses have been defined under law to include legal obligations, expenditures specifically authorized by statute, and other items necessary to maintain the educational program, preserve property, and ensure the health and safety of the students and staff. I would like to refer the board to the line-by-line budget, and it says Attachment A. And I would just like to point out a few things. If you turn to page 9, page 9, and it says, where you see it's circled on page 9, if you look at page 9 at the top, and you see it's circled, 2110, 13201, you see high school teachers, that's 5.5 teachers, and this is as a result of the reallocation of the $505,000 that was removed from transportation. The teacher collaboration model, you can see $147,315. I'd like for you to move to page 16, and you will see where the transportation line item has been readjusted, minus the $505,000. If you go down to the teacher's retirement and the Social Security and the medical insurance, all three of these items circled due to the teacher increase of and now I'd like to turn it over to Mr. Weissmandel to further this discussion.
Thank you. Is there any discussion from the board?
What would be the impact on the previous years? There's been a refund of the tax increase based on the state law. What would be the impact this year and in future years?
In terms of the rebate, the state has been winding down the rebate program for next year and for the year to come. The rebate for New York State taxpayers will be based on a sliding scale, which will be rated based on the aggregate income for the last 2 years. The sliding scale is a income sliding scale that ranges from salaries less than 25,000, between 25 and 75,000, all the way to over 200,000. So depending on where the taxpayer's income fall, that's what the amount. But again, the amount of rebate are going to be much smaller than what they used to be, because the state is closing that down.
Would there be any rebate this year, or it's because with an override would it be canceled out?
In terms of the rebate, again, that depends on your specific situation with the tax income. What this increase on tax levy does is that, put it this way, let's say you have a house of $500,000, full market. You have a house that market judges as a $500,000. If we had stayed on the tax cap, this household would have paid $120 annually, or $10. The increase is $120 annually, or $10 per month. with the tax, with the new additional 1% override, this family will pay another additional $70, which means $190 will be the total amount of increase on this family that owns this this house that on the full value is assessed at $500,000. So we're talking about from $120 to $190, $70 increase, annual increase per month, which that's the effect of the tax cap, of the overriding the tax cap.
I just want to make sure I understand what you said before correctly, right, that the way the rebate works now is...
Starting from next year, yes.
That in the past was if there was an override, there was no rebate. But now there's a rebate, but it's not based on what the taxes are, it's based on the sliding
scale. The rebate now will be based on the income. First, on the income, of, on the what category does the household income falls? Mm-hmm. That will define the amount of the rebates.
Mr. Pacci, I believe that if...
But if what the person will not get the rebate, even if it is a small rebate, because we're going over the cap.
Okay.
The person will not get that rebate, right, but the rebate will be very small on that part.
Right, but this year there would be no rebate. Next year,
I'm talking about 17, 18 again.
Correct.
Yeah.
And in 18, 19, if we stayed within the tax cap,
then the rebate returns. That's the condition. To have a rebate, a family must, the school district and the town should stay on the tax cap, should have a minimum, should be star eligible, and a minimum of, and a household income of less than $275,000. So that's how you get a rebate. But again, the rebate is not what it used to be 2 years ago. Last year, which means this year, the taxpayers got fixed amount of rebates based on where they live. Rockland County residents, they got $185 rebate. That was the determination of New York State for the Rockland County residents. So next year now, this one goes out, and you go now on a sliding scale.
The other question I have is, was there consideration of people who are living on fixed income or are unemployed or underemployed or have low income and are living paycheck to paycheck, where 1% doesn't sound like so much, but 1% on top of the tax cap, you know, impacts people's monthly finances?
That's true. And this was, again, the best we come, when we did this, we tried to come with the best of what is affordable for the resident that lives in all three towns that compose our school district, and what the needs of the school district in terms of public education and transportations are. And again, we are starting from a low base, given that in many previous years the budget had been defeated, so our base is slightly lower than we should have been. So we're sort of cashing up.
Mr. Grossman, if I can address your question. The challenge with presenting a budget is a challenge that the board deals with every year, and part of that challenge is balancing the needs and the budget of the district, along with putting out a budget that will pass the taxpayers' vote. That is the uniqueness of a school budget, that we put it out to the voters. We don't vote it ourselves. We present it to the voters, but the voters either approve or deny the budget. If you look back at our recent history, the years 2010, 11, 12, and 13, the budget failed on the first try. The last 3 years, the budget actually passed on the first try. And it was our ability to present the budget that the community felt was reasonable in tax increase and put back programs in all the right places. The monitors have been pushing this concept for a long time, And it's a tough question. How will individual voters feel about it? And how are the voters able to handle another 1% in tax increase? And that is a question that honestly, I don't think we have the answer. That is why we're putting it out to the voters. For the voters to look at it, analyze it, and decide if they are willing and prepared to undertake an additional 1% increase on our tax base. Anyone else?
I have a question. I think going back to page 9. I noticed for the non-instructional salary for the teachers collaboration model, the previous budget that was given to us, it included in that title translate. Is there a difference between?
No, that's they are all non-instructor salary, including the translator. That's simply a title of the
translate.
Sometimes when you hire temps as translators, they are it's the same code. It's one.
So it makes no difference.
Nothing changed. But the entire amount of money that we added there from last will go to a teacher collaboration model, not to the translators.
Okay, and on page 16 with the transportation.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to understand the difference between this new revised budget and the one that was given to us, where I noticed there's the increase for the first three.
First, we reduced it by 505. First we reduced the budget by $505,000, and then again the new with the new increase on the tax levy, we increased the transportation by $1,414,000. So that's a what you see there. The number that you see here is a net combination of a decrease of $505,000 and an increase of $1,414,000.
So I think the difference that I notice at the for the function subtotal is $909,000.
Right. Because again, we have to remove $505,000 mm-hmm. and reallocate, and then we had to add $1,414,000.
Okay.
That's the net. Yes. Okay. And it's spread through the three lines of the transportation,
the
regular,
first
special equipped vehicles, and over 20 lines.
Okay.
At a ratio of 90%, 5%, 5%.
Okay, thank you.
So in reality, if the budget fails, are we losing only the 1%, or are we going back to the original zero?
If the budget fails, the board has the authority to make a decision to add to one. Either go with the contingency budget, and you don't have to go to the voters. You may go, but you don't. Or ask the school district superintendent to submit a new budget, which is less than this. Otherwise, will not work.
Thank you.
Or submit the budget to stay on the cap.
Kathy, when is the public hearing?
If the board adopts the new budget, we're going to reschedule the public hearing. The date we have is May 8th.
A week before the budget vote.
There will be a budget meeting.
A week before the vote.
It'll give everybody enough time to study the paperwork and come ask questions. Anyone else on the board? Action items regarding the budget. Is there any more discussion on the budget item? Or can we have our clerk present the resolution? Kathy.
Okay, this is to adopt a revised proposed budget. Be it resolved that upon the recommendation of the Superintendent of Schools, the Board of Education hereby approves and adopts the revised proposed budget for the fiscal year commencing July 1st, 2017 and ending June 30th, 2018 in the amount of $232,578,879 and the corresponding property tax report card. Adoption of this budget requires a tax levy increase of 2.49%, which exceeds the statutory tax levy increase limit of 1.48% for this school fiscal year, and therefore exceeds the state tax cap and must be approved by 60% of the qualified voters present and voting.
Thank you. I will move just to clarify, Dr. Wortham, this budget has been sent up to the commission already.
Exactly. I was just getting ready to ask permission to say that, yes, the commissioner, when she asked for the budget to be resubmitted, put a date of April 28th. Today is Wednesday, April 26th, and we have submitted the budget to the commissioner as presented this evening.
Do you believe we'll have a response by the next, by the public hearing?
Yes.
Okay. So I'll make a motion to adopt this resolution. Is there a second? Second by Mr. Charles. All in favor say aye. Anyone opposed or abstain? Motion carries. Before we move on, Mr. Charles, you had mentioned to me about joining the bond committee. Were you still interested in that? Or joining the bond committee? I wanted to bring to the attention of the board a request from Mr. Charles to be an additional board member on the bond committee. Is there any objection to adding at this point? Mr. Charles, clear your schedule.
Mr. Weissmittle, there's another resolution you should pass. Rescheduling the public hearing.
You want to read that?
Yeah, because the public hearing must be at least 7 days after adoption of the budget. The public hearing that we had noticed for May 2nd is only 6 days. So the resolution
Tuesday is being rescheduled?
For Monday. We can reschedule the entire meeting if that's what you want.
For the following Monday.
For the following Monday. So be
able
to That'll
be the board meeting as well.
If that's what the board chooses.
Yeah, I believe so.
Okay. Be it resolved that upon the recommendation of the Superintendent of Schools, the Board of Education hereby sets a revised date for the public hearing on the 2017-18 budget of Monday, May 8th, 2017, due to the district's need to comply with the timelines set out in education law for providing sufficient notice of the budget hearing. And I will advertise that as extensively as I can.
We have to vote on this?
Yes.
Moved on the resolution for the public hearing. Is there a second? Second by Mr. Hapstein. All in favor say aye. Anyone opposed or abstain? Motion carries. I will now make a motion to adjourn for a brief.